Dr. Saad for his amazing organization of this scientific day and his great effort for this day. Now we present lecturer Dr. Kareem Nawwar to present his lecture about controlled hypotensive anaesthesia, a myth or reality. This is a very important topic. Dr. Kareem Nawwar is a lecturer of anaesthesiology, intensive care, Cairo University. You can start, Dr. Kareem, to talk about your subject.
Thank you, Dr. Eman. Thank you, Dr. Saad. It's a great pleasure to participate in such a great and somehow traditional topic, maybe considered as an old one. But continuous debate always continues about the use or application and how it can be applied or used beneficially to benefit our patients. Our topic about controlled hypotensive anaesthesia, is it a myth, all the myth and truth about the topic? Okay. An old quotation declared that induced hypotension should be only used to make the impossible possible, not to make the possible easy. There was a time when surgeons were largely unaware to that dictum, and induced hypotension had many indications, particularly for neurosurgical and head and neck procedures. Nowadays, occasional surgeons will still insist that hypotension is essential in cosmetic procedures such as rhinoplasty, but in reality, the genuine indications have now shrunk to the point at which the technique is confined to a very few, very specialized surgical procedures such as removal of choroidal tumors of the eye. The traditional indications of controlled hypotensive anaesthesia include variable surgical procedures. Maybe the indications have shrunk greatly nowadays, but the traditional indications include microsurgery, such as middle ear surgery, mastoid surgery, intraocular tumors, and orbital and ocular oculoplastic surgeries. Neurosurgical procedures, especially vascular, neurovascular ones, including cerebral aneurysms and AV malformations, vascular and plastic surgeries to prevent anastomotic disruption, major cancer surgeries such as total laryngectomy, radical neck dissection, maxillofacial mastectomy, and pelvic excentration, which helps tumor tissue clearance. Another indication is to decrease the massive blood loss and decreasing the need for transfusion, such as in total hip replacement. And the final indication is to decrease the intraocular pressure in lens extraction and in vitrectomy procedures. But what is our goal during controlled hypotensive anaesthesia? Our goal is to provide elective reduction of arterial blood pressure, to provide a dry operative field, to improve field visibility, and to decrease the need for suction and electrocautery during surgery, meanwhile decreasing blood loss and the need for blood transfusion, but while maintaining vital organ perfusion, which is now the most important item or the most important concern in nowadays studies. We may meet the name elective hypotension or induced hypotension or controlled hypotension or deliberate hypotension all have the same meaning, which is controlled hypotension. Traditionally, we were aiming to lower the blood pressure to target systolic blood pressure between 60 and 80 millimeter mercury and mean blood pressure between 50 and 60 millimeter mercury. However, the concept has modified to target individualized induced hypotension based on the patient baseline blood pressure to target a reduction of 25% of its value. In normotensive patients, we usually target a systolic blood pressure of a range between 80 and 90 and a mean blood pressure between 60 and 65 millimeter mercury. But keep in mind that bradycardia or achieving bradycardia is of equal importance, if not more important than hypotension itself. But before we start to induce hypotensive anaesthesia, we should think twice, because it is important to assess accurately the patient's ability to tolerate induced hypotension without end organ injury. Therefore, care must be taken to maintain a safe minimum blood pressure to assure adequate cerebral, coronary, and renal perfusion. Preoperative patient preparation and evaluation includes a focused cardiovascular history and investigation to determine coronary artery disease, cerebrovascular disease, peripheral arterial disease, or arrhythmias. Positive findings in such history or investigations may alter some details or techniques in the protocol we practice, such as the degree of head elevation or the use of topical vasoconstrictors or the anesthetic technique, and the degree of induced hypotension we target. Systemic absorption of locally injected vasoconstrictor agents may cause hemodynamic instability in the form of hypertension, bradycardia or tachycardia, or arrhythmias. Rapid response to these effects is necessary to prevent further complications. Alpha agonist induced hypertension due to the injected vasoconstrictors in patients on beta blockers or calcium channel blockers may lead to pulmonary embolism or heart failure. Various contraindications to the such technique, including first anesthetic factors, which are the lack of technical experience or inability to monitor the patient adequately. Other patient factors include coronary artery disease, especially in the last 6 months, fixed cardiac output, such as aortic stenosis or cardiomyopathy, peripheral vascular disease, ischemic cerebrovascular disease, renal or hepatic insufficiency, severe anemia or hypovolemia, uncontrolled hypertension, or uncontrolled glaucoma. Do we need special monitoring during hypotensive anaesthesia? Yes, it depends mostly on the procedure itself, whether it's an extensive procedure or a simple one, or a lengthy operation or a short one. Basically, we need an ECG monitor with an ST segment analysis to detect any cardiac ischemia, ischemic event. Invasive blood pressure measurement may be needed if lengthy operation is anticipated, in addition to urine output monitoring if extensive surgery such as head and neck surgery or maxillectomy or maxillofacial operations. But how can we achieve hypotensive anaesthesia? This is actually not the target or the main target of our presentation, but we will run over the main protocols or strategies to attain such hypotension. it is classified to non-pharmacological and pharmacological methods. Non-pharmacological methods includes head up position and positive pressure ventilation. The pharmacological methods includes avoiding pressure response to laryngoscopy and intubation, local injection of vasoconstrictors and hypotensive agents. We start with the head up position. The head is elevated 15 degrees to facilitate venous drainage. This, as such, may give some modest hypotension by decreasing the regional blood pressure, but it carries the risk of potential venous pooling in the lower limbs, which may cause deep venous thrombosis in lengthy procedures. The head is placed on a headrest with variable degrees of lateral rotation of the neck. Extreme torsion on the heads of the sternocleidomastoid muscles should be avoided. Avoiding the pressure response, we all know the techniques of how we avoid the pressure response of laryngoscopy and intubation using pre-medication with clonidine or opioids or deepening anaesthesia, or using lidocaine either IV or intratracheal instillation or topical spray, or even using beta blocker before intubation or before laryngoscopy and intubation to finally reach a laryngoscopic time of less than 15 seconds. Local injection of vasoconstrictors, usually done by the surgeon. Concentrated epinephrine solution can be injected locally, but close attention to the volume of injected epinephrine is mandatory to avoid dysrhythmias and wide blood pressure swinging. About hypotensive agents, the prime determinants of arterial blood pressure are the cardiac output times the systemic vascular resistance. The hypotensive agents are classified according to the target action into drugs affecting the cardiac output, which include the beta adrenergic receptors blockers and the alpha 2 adrenal receptor blockers. Drugs affecting the systemic vascular resistance include alpha 1 adrenal receptor blockers, peripheral vasodilators, ganglion blockers, and direct vasodilators. We'll run over the drug pharmacology. Phentolamine is an alpha antagonist, rapid onset 1 to 2 minutes, effective duration of 15 minutes. Glycerol trinitrate, which is the nitroglycerin or the triadiene. It is a venodilator more than arterial, rapid onset and offset, infusion rate starting from 0.5 mic per kg per minute, no rebound hypertension, but it increases the cerebral blood flow and the intracranial pressure. Tolerance may develop on continuous use. Sodium nitroprusside, both arterial and venous action, but the disadvantages include unstable solution. So the given set must be protected from light. Also, it has a rapid onset and rapid offset, has the risk of toxicity by production of the free cyanide, may cause rebound hypertension on discontinuation. Trimetafen is a ganglion blocker, I think rarely used nowadays, but it is a releaser of histamine, which may contribute to its hypotensive action. Hydralazine is an arteriolar dilator more than a venous dilator. Main use is in the control of hypertension in pregnancy. Now, the beta blockers are much largely used and practiced in our protocols. All are competitive antagonists with variable selectivity for receptors. The target useful characteristic is to have a selective beta 1 antagonistic effect. Their influence on blood pressure is due to decreasing the cardiac output by decreasing the heart rate, together with some inhibition of the renin-angiotensin system. The unopposed alpha-1 vasoconstriction may compromise the peripheral circulation, but without causing hypertension. Examples of the beta blockers include propranolol, which is the Inderal, or we have the Maestrotens. It is a non-selective beta antagonist given in 1 milligram bolus, repeated up to a maximum of 5 milligram in anesthetized patients. The short-acting form of the beta blockers is the esmolol, which is a selective beta-1 antagonist used by infusion. The last beta blocker used is the labetalol or the trendate, acting as an alpha and beta antagonist, but mainly it has a beta antagonistic action, decreasing the systemic vascular resistance without causing reflex tachycardia. Popular in anesthetic and obstetric and ICU use, may be given as a bolus or an infusion. And finally, the alpha adrenoceptor agonist, including the clonidine, which appeared first, previously used for a long time. It acts by decreasing the central sympathetic outflow and stimulating the presynaptic alpha 2 receptors, such way decreasing the noradrenaline release into the synaptic cleft. It has the advantage of being of having analgesic and sedative action, but the elimination half-life is too long, about 14 hours, so which long half-life this long half-life can enable us to adjust, finally control the blood pressure, thereby only used as an adjunct in low doses. The recently introduced member of the same group is the dexmedetomidine, more selective alpha-2 agonist than the clonidine, with more effects on the central alpha receptors, with a loaded dose of 1 mic per kg over 10 minutes, then infusion or maintenance dose from 0.2 to 0.7 mic per kg per hour. Magnesium sulfate, which is widely used also, it is a calcium antagonist, decreasing calcium channel activity in the vascular smooth muscles, decreasing intracellular calcium, causing relaxation and vasodilation. Decreases also the release of noradrenaline by blocking the N-type calcium channels at the nerve endings, increase nitric oxide production, thus also causing vasodilatation. 2 points regarding the use of the beta blockers during hypotensive anaesthesia. Number one is using beta blockers in presence of history of bronchial asthma or chest allergy. Patients usually lie in one of three categories. Category one is the atopic patient, which have allergic sinusitis or chronic sinusitis together with bronchial asthma due to presence of atopy in the patient. Number two is the patients misdiagnosed to have bronchial asthma before being diagnosed to have an upper airway problem, such as chronic allergic sinusitis, and midway, the hyperactive airway group, which is patient having a chronic postnasal discharge when receives medications or drugs to improve the sinusitis condition, the chest condition also improves. Clinically, or during examination or preoperative examination of the patient, we may find chest wheezing, and we also may find history of use of bronchodilators. Mostly in type 1 and type 2 patients. but in type 3, we may not notice any wheezing, chest wheezing, or may the patient may be used to use bronchodilators, but stopped using it after being diagnosed to have a chronic sinusitis or an allergic sinusitis. The literature is full of studies comparing the recently introduced agents to as an adjunct or as a tools to achieve hypotensive anaesthesia. This study is comparing dexmedetomidine with remifentanil, which concluded that dexmedetomidine is of limited value and has no additional benefits. In addition, it has a high recovery time. It has the disadvantage of prolonging recovery time and post-operative first hour post-operative sedation score, post-operative sedation, which is something unwanted in sinus surgery, which where we target to have the patient awake and aware to avoid aspiration. The study comparing remifentanil, magnesium sulfate, and dexmedetomidine in intraoperative hypotension and bleeding and postoperative recovery. They concluded that in dexmedetomidine group, it showed the least amount of blood loss and the lower blood pressure and heart rate, which is the hypotensive goal, and but the recovery time was higher due to a postoperative sedation. This study was comparing dexmedetomidine and esmolol, and concluded that dexmedetomidine caused the prolongation of the time of first hold for analgesic, which means it has a post-operative analgesic effect with post-operative sedation, but esmolol had the advantage of more rapid recovery. This study compared the efficacy between clonidine and his related member of family, dexmedetomidine, and concluded strangely that no significant difference between both drugs in reduction of the surgical bleeding, and recommended the use of clonidine due to a longer experience with the drug and its lower cost. This study was comparing esmolol with the total intravenous anaesthesia, and concluded that esmolol was superior than remifentanil in controlling pressor response of induction and reduction of the blood loss and operative time. This study compared esmolol, remifentanil, nitroglycerin in controlled hypotension also. It concluded that remifentanil was less caused less volatile agent consumption, short time to achieve controlled hypotension, lower surgical field bleeding score, but the nitroglycerin was less costly and more efficiently achieving the target median arterial blood pressure and less postoperative complication. But we should consider the other aspect of the protocol or the technique. Is it safe? Is it absolutely safe to deliver hypotensive anaesthesia to our patient or not? This systematic review was conducted and asked a question: is deliberate hypotension a safe technique for orthopedic surgery? Systematic review and meta-analysis, and concluded that in orthopedic surgery, it is, which is the other in main family of indications to induce hypotensive anaesthesia, they concluded that it is unclear whether or not deliberate hypotension is a safe technique for orthopedic surgery or not, and it may decrease the intraoperative blood loss and blood transfusion volume. This means it they were unaware, or it was unclear for them about the safety of the protocol. The major concern about the safety of hypotensive anaesthesia is the organ autoregulation, mainly the cerebral autoregulation. The cerebral autoregulation is the ability of the cerebral blood vessels to tolerate mean blood pressure swinging between 50 and 150 millimeter mercury, with little affection of the cerebral blood flow to maintain cerebral perfusion pressure. Any decrease in the cerebral perfusion pressure will lead to cerebral vasodilatation, which in turn will increase the cerebral blood flow. Beyond these limits, cerebral blood flow becomes pressure dependent, which means that at mean arterial blood pressure below 50 millimeter mercury, cerebral blood vessels are maximally dilated. So any decrease in the mean blood pressure will decrease the cerebral blood flow, leading to cerebral hypoperfusion or ischemia. This diagram illustrates the principle of autoregulation. The autoregulation range of mean blood pressure between 50 and 150. Any increase in the blood pressure, the cerebral vessels to compensate by vasoconstricting to limit the cerebral perfusion, cerebral blood flow, sorry, to maintain stable cerebral perfusion pressure. And vice versa, any decrease in the cerebral blood flow, any decrease in the mean arterial blood pressure towards the lower limit of autoregulation range will increase the vasodilatation of the cerebral vessels to maintain the cerebral blood flow. But beyond these limits, our target is the region or the area around this mean value of 50 millimeter mercury. Beyond this limit, the autoregulation mechanism is not reliable enough. So any decrease in the mean blood pressure will decrease also the cerebral blood flow, leading to ischemia. Cerebral autoregulation curve is shifted to the right in the chronic uncontrolled hypertension due to widespread vasoconstriction. Therefore, in hypertensive patients, they can better tolerate marked increase in mean arterial blood pressure more than the normotensives. At mean arterial pressure as low as 60 millimeter mercury, this would be tolerated in normotensives, but may lie below the lower limit of autoregulation in hypertensive patients, which may lead to hypoperfusion. This illustrates this piece of information. The curve is shifted to the right in hypertensive patients. In chronic hypertensives, the curve is lifted to the right. So when we target a mean blood pressure of, let's say, 60 millimeter mercury, in normotensive patients, it lies near the plateau of the curve, or just on the plateau of the curve. So no change or no compromise in the cerebral blood flow reaching the brain tissue. However, if we look at the hypertensive patients, this point of 60 millimeter mercury lies on the slope of the curve, which means a compromise in the cerebral blood flow, leading to ischemia or hypoperfusion. However, cerebral autoregulation curve is shifted to the left in vasodilator-induced hypotension. But the autoregulation altogether is abolished, meaning absent plateau of the curve with the use of potent potent volatile anaesthetics. This is when the old school or the old protocol of hypotensive anaesthesia was depending on solely the high concentration of the volatile agents. This can abolish the autoregulation curve altogether. So the potential dangers and complications during hypotensive anaesthesia includes cerebral ischemia, as we said, as autoregulation is maintained till mean arterial pressure above 50 millimeter mercury. Likewise, myocardial ischemia or infarction, but the autoregulation is maintained till mean arterial blood pressure above 80 millimeter mercury. Renal ischemia causing temporary oliguria or acute tubular necrosis when the mean blood pressure decreases below 60 or 65 millimeter mercury. Decreased intraocular pressure or retinal artery thrombosis, reaction hemorrhage and hematoma formation, or deep venous thrombosis. This study or this case report was mentioned in, I think, 1964 or 63, telling a catastrophic story titled Cerebral Complications of Hypotensive Anaesthesia in a Healthy Adult. This is a striking title. The summary of the story: the case of a healthy, normotensive woman of 43 years old, subjected to a cosmetic operation under hypotensive anaesthesia, is reported. Head up till the 20 degrees was maintained during an operation period of 1 hour 55 minutes. Return of consciousness was delayed and was followed by an organic dementia persisting until death 1 year and 11 months later. This tells us that the issue is very serious, and the complications may be lifelong. This study compared hypotensive anaesthesia versus normotensive anaesthesia during major maxillofacial surgeries, and they stressed on multiple points during patient selection. As we mentioned, patients with disseminated vascular disease or patients with ischemic vascular disease or carotid artery stenosis should receive, they reported that they should receive a modified hypotensive anaesthesia adjust to their conditions. They also highlighted the hypertensive patients that they have contracted blood volume and there is a risk of profound and rapid decrease in blood pressure when attaining hypotensive anaesthesia. So recommended appropriate volume replacement prior to commencing hypotensive anaesthesia. Patients with the preoperative kidney disease may have an exacerbated renal function postoperatively, and noted that the renal functions are affected mainly by the cardiac output and blood flow in the splanchnic circulation and not by the systemic arterial pressure. Thus, blood pressure measurements may not accurately indicate the actual renal perfusion pressure. They noted that also a calcium channel blocker, which is nicardipine, was recommended in a study that it may have a protective role in such a complication. They concluded that the management, the magnitude of blood pressure reduction should be adjusted to the patient's general condition, age, and existing disease. Appropriate patient selection and careful monitoring and adequate intraoperative volume replacement are mandatory in hypotensive anaesthesia. This study focused on neuroanesthetic practice and the role of permissive or induced hypotension, and concluded that the main indication or the main persistent indication of hypotensive anaesthesia, or they named it the permissive hypotension, in the neurovascular surgeries. Now, various studies have documented the incidence and the prevalence of risk associated with the intraoperative hypotension in general. In such study in the European Journal of Anaesthesia, intraoperative hypotension is associated with myocardial damage in cardiac surgery. They concluded that an association between an intraoperative reduction of systemic blood pressure more than 50% from the baseline, lasting for more than 5 minutes, and myocardial damage. Another study called the Vision Study in anaesthesia analgesia concluded that intraoperative tachycardia and hypotension are associated with myocardial injury after non-cardiac surgeries. Another study in the International Journal for ICU titled "The Perioperative Myocardial Injury and the Contribution of Hypotension." They concluded that myocardial injury appears as the leading cause in mortality in the period 1 month following surgery, and found a strong association between hypotension and myocardial injury, renal injury, and death. They concluded also that reducing hypotension may improve perioperative outcomes. Another study, association between the intraoperative hypotension with acute kidney injury after elective non-cardiac surgery, and their results was a reduction of the mean arterial blood pressure less than 60 millimeter mercury for less than 20 minutes, or reduction in mean arterial blood pressure less than 55 minutes for more than 10 minutes were associated with the increased risk. Another study in anaesthesiology titled "The Preoperative Risk and Association Between Hypotension and Postoperative Acute Kidney Injury." They concluded that in patients with medium risk, with medium preoperative risk, severe range of intraoperative hypotension was associated with complications, while in patients with highest risk, the even mild range of hypotension was associated with complications. They concluded also that the absolute hypotension, which is the absolute figure of blood pressure in millimeter mercury, is the main factor and not the relative hypotension, which is the percentage of decrease from the baseline. This study, again, in the British Journal of Anaesthesia, intraoperative hypotension and the risk of postoperative adverse outcome, a systematic review, and concluded that there was an association suggesting that organ injury might occur when mean arterial blood pressure decreases below 80 millimeter mercury for more than 10 minutes. And this risk increases with the blood pressures becoming progressively lower. Another editorial in the British Journal of Anaesthesia titled "Making Sense of the Impact of Intraoperative Hypotension from Population to Individual Patients." They showed that a slight increased risk of injury was confirmed by a mean blood pressure below 80 millimeter mercury for more than 10 minutes, or below 70 millimeter mercury for less than 10 minutes, and high risk of injury was seen when mean blood pressure below 65 millimeter mercury for more than 20 minutes and mean pressure below 50 millimeter mercury for more than 5 minutes or below 40 millimeter mercury for any duration. They also concluded that blood pressure at lower limit of autoregulation, the blood pressure at the lower limit of autoregulation at which the blood flow to vital organs is pressure dependent for an individual is highly variable. And we are unaware of accurate method to predict this threshold in any given patient. So we are still unable to definitely point to intraoperative hypotension as the culprit of adverse outcomes. Finally, the target of this presentation is if we considered this hemodynamic profile, the balanced anaesthetic practice, targeting a normal tension and normal sinus rhythm, nor bradycardic, neither bradycardic nor tachycardic. We are not in hypotensive anaesthesia. We are not targeting such hemodynamic profile. We are not targeting aggressive hypotension in such as that image with accompanied with that sinus tachycardia, because this will not be beneficial neither for the patient nor for the surgeon. But if we can reach it, if we can reach such hemodynamic profile of just minimal hypotension and sinus bradycardia, this would be of much benefit for both the patients and the surgeon. Thank you.
Thanks a lot, Dr. Kareem. It's a very perfect lecture. You said about hypotensive anaesthesia, which is the most crucial negotiation between the surgeon and the anaesthetist. Now you covered all about hypotensive anaesthesia, about the medication, about the indication, about complications of hypotensive anaesthesia, and what is the most recent studies about how to manage the blood pressure of the patient for different crucial target about the patient, about the surgeon, about the type of the operation. You do a great effort for this lecture. Thanks a lot, Dr.